Obviously, with the hour we have here, we've had more than enough time to explore every possible aspect of that question and deal with all your questions as well. Of course, I'm being ironic, and one of the hard things about dealing with disinformation is that sometimes people are saying ironic things and need to be understood as making an attempt at humor. And you've heard now from me a lame attempt at humor that is just as good as the lame attempts at humor you encountered on Twitter and elsewhere. We have some really great speakers here today, but I want to outline, before I introduce them to you, I want to outline what we hope that you get from our panel today. And it's basically this. We are, each of us and many of our colleagues are funded to do research on social media and democracy and politics and public policy relating to disinformation, as well as questions like freedom of speech, democratic health, how we make good decisions and craft our policies that protect what we think is important in our culture. And I'm going to ask you right now, if you feel like something participatory, this is participatory democracy, how many of you have ever had anyone refer an Onion article to you as if it were a real news story? Yeah, no, that never happens, right? Of course it does happen. One of the difficulties that we have in the internet, when you have this disintermediated contact between individual users and a vast source of material, some of which is true, some of which is false, and some of which is artistic, that it's hard to come up with a one-size-fits-all answer to the questions that these new media raise. And it might be said very broadly that if we came up with public policy that didn't lead to outlawing Onion articles, we probably would have at least gotten something right. We don't want to outlaw Onion articles. But what I want to do in terms of outlining the structure of this panel is that we're each, I'm going to give a few opening remarks besides this one, and I'm going to introduce the panelists. We're each going to talk for about no more than 10 minutes about our subject matter areas of inquiry. And then we will have some dialogue among ourselves. I'll ask some questions. And then ideally, we will have some time, 15 or 20 minutes, before the end of the hour to engage all of you. I know you may have questions that we haven't anticipated. And ideally, we will anticipate some of them. So let me just do a very brief introduction. I'm going to ask my fellow panelists to expand on my introduction of them as required, because all of these people are quite accomplished, and I can't possibly list all of their credentials. But I'm going to just introduce very briefly, and I'll start with Zeev Sanderson at my far end. Zeev is the executive director of the Center for Social Media and Politics at New York University. That center is relatively new. It was founded just about 3 years ago, 2 or 3 years ago, built on a media studies laboratory at NYU. And he'll have some talk today about how good we are at summarize everything he's going to say, but he will at least address the question of how good we are at detecting fake news. It turns out we may not be totally great at it. My next to Zeev is Ramsi Woodcock from the University of Kentucky, who has, as I described him earlier, has a foot in the world of law school and a foot in the world of business school. His lawyer has published an excellent article in Yale Law Journal about whether we have actually passed the point of whether advertising on the internet or anywhere is functional, socially useful, and he'll clarify that argument. But in addition, I think it's important to recognize that in American culture, we have taken the view for a long time, for many decades now, that advertising is protected speech in the First Amendment. So there are some open questions about whether that was the right public policy-related interpretation of the First Amendment. And he'll unpack some of that for us. And then finally, last but not least of the people I'm introducing is Kathleen Carley, who is a social scientist who's done an immense amount of work at Carnegie Mellon University, most recently in the general fields of disinformation and misinformation. And here, I'm going to take the opportunity to make a distinction between misinformation and disinformation. As you know, human beings being what they are, there's a lot of misinformation out in the world. There's a lot of false ideas or false information out in the world. And that is itself a problem. But in addition to that, there's a different term that sounds like it's the same, but doesn't quite mean the same. Disinformation, which has to do with intentionally using aspects of the information ecosystem to mislead people. And interestingly enough, and I always repeat this every time I talk about disinformation, which may come from foreign actors and active measures, or may come from domestic actors. Disinformation may actually include true statements. It may actually include true information, but it's used in a way that's manipulative or misleading or otherwise destructive. So that's about the main part of the introduction of the people that I want to do here. But what I also want to add are some thoughts that I have in my own work. My name is Mike Godwin. I'm a distinguished senior fellow at the Varsity Institute. I've been working on social media and democracy issues for a long time, for 30 years. And I'm also a trustee and member of the Board of Trustees of the Internet Society, so I try to stay abreast of internet-related public policy issues. And I've been writing about, I'm primarily a First Amendment lawyer, and so I think about free speech issues all the time. One of the things that I recently posted an article on Slate just last week that centered on the idea that we now have people raising questions about whether we have too much free speech, whether freedom of speech and the First Amendment have been interpreted so broadly that we, in effect, have turned them into a suicide pact. We have so much freedom of speech that it's potentially doing damage to our democratic culture. And these are hard questions. And it's hard for me to cope with after putting in all the time that I've done on protecting freedom of speech. And one thing that I think is worth thinking about, I'll just give you some ideas that may help you frame it, is that, if I'm sitting in a bar and somebody, there's a hostile drunk next to me who's a little guy, but he wants to take a fight with me, and I'm not going to let him. Maybe I can dodge him, maybe he can't hurt me. The question is not whether he can hurt me. That's not really the question. If he takes a swing at me and misses, or if he takes a swing at me and doesn't hurt me, that's not the question. The question is it lawful to take a swing? Is it lawful even to try to assault me? And the public policy answer, the legal answer is yes, you can still arrest that guy, right? You can still arrest the puny drunk who couldn't hurt you. Because we recognize that attempts to do damage to one another are themselves things that it is lawful to prohibit. I think that the final idea that I want to raise is this, and that's that the social consensus in the United States about the idea that commercial speech or advertising-related speech is protected by the First Amendment is relatively recent and happened really just in the last few decades, partly as a product of Supreme Court decisions. Prior to that, it was generally perceived to be the case that the Federal Trade Commission and other agencies, certainly in the scope of their commerce powers or federal regulatory powers, could regulate even true commercial speech if it was manipulative or, in the language of the Federal Trade Act, unfair. Unfair is a pretty broad rubric. One other note that I'll come back to is that for about 75 years, we've been living in a world in which the propaganda techniques that were used in warfare, particularly starting in World War II, are things that have increasingly been adapted to our commercial culture. So the idea of manipulating ordinary citizens through commercial advertising, through other kinds of advertising, is something that's been out there for longer than, I assume, longer than anyone here in this room has been alive. So that's something worth remembering as well. And with that, I think I'm just going to shift to Steve, who will start out and introduce himself further if he wants to, and talk about the research work his center is doing.
Great, thank you. I'd like to thank R Street and Mike Godwin for hosting this panel, as well as Ramsi and Kathleen for participating in this dialogue. My name is Dean Sanderson, as Mike said, and I'm the Executive Director for the Center of Social Media and Politics, an interdisciplinary research center at NYU where misinformation is one of our core areas of interest. Before sort of briefly venturing into a question of public policy, I first want to highlight two broad themes that run through the diverse computational literature on misinformation before stressing the importance of increased data access for researchers. The first broad theme I'd like to highlight is the significant heterogeneity in patterns of online misinformation consumption, sharing, and exposure. Put another way, research shows that different groups of people are vulnerable to misinformation at different rates and in different contexts. A study by Grinberg and others last year found that while fake news accounted for roughly 6% of all news consumption during 2016, it was heavily concentrated. Only 1% of users were exposed to 80% of fake news, and only 0.1% of users were responsible for 80% of its sharing. They also found that older people were more likely to share misinformation, a finding echoed by the Guest, Nagler, and Tucker study out of our center last year, which estimated that people 65 and older were 7 times more likely to share fake news on Facebook during 2016 than were those aged 18 to 25. Here, we think that age is a proxy for digital literacy, or the ability to evaluate information online. Beyond age, work by scholars like Dean Freelon and Kate Starberg have highlighted how communities of color have been targeted by online misinformation campaigns from accounts using sock puppet identities. However, these dynamics are rarely incorporated into the public's understanding of misinformation. In November of last year, a highly publicized report estimated that there had been 158 million views of fake news on Facebook throughout 2019. Outlets picked up on this finding, and some of the media quickly warned of a new misinformation epidemic. This focus on the scale or prevalence of misinformation was reminiscent of coverage in the run-up to and the postmortem for the 2016 election, in which aggregate counts of shares or views of misinformation were widely reported on. What this framing obscures, however, is the wide heterogeneity of who is likely to consume, be exposed to, and share misinformation. And whether you're a policymaker crafting, say, a digital literacy intervention, an engineer, technologist building tools and systems to make our online information ecosystems more resilient, or a journalist covering misinformation that lead up to the 2020 presidential election, an understanding of this heterogeneity is vital. The second broad theme I want to highlight today is that developments in research on the production and consumption of misinformation far outpaces our understanding of the downstream effects. At a high level, research on misinformation is animated by 4 key questions. Who produces it, who shares it, who is exposed to it, and what's the effect of that exposure? As the studies I just referenced and many others like them demonstrate, the research community has made significant strides in studying the production, sharing, and exposure of misinformation. But we know comparatively much less about the final question. What are the effects of exposure on political behaviors and attitudes? This is not to say that misinformation has no effect. Rather, I want to offer a general word of caution against conflating evidence of the prevalence of misinformation on the one hand with evidence of a direct effect on what people believe or for whom they vote on the other. To quickly return to the widely reported on 150 million views of fake news, while the report provides evidence for the continued circulation of misinformation in the Facebook ecosystem, the number in itself tells us nothing about whether there were any effects on people's downstream political opinions, beliefs, or behaviors. In order to fully understand the nature and scope of the problems posed by misinformation, this difference between activity and effect is a necessary distinction to make. As Yohai Benkler, director of Harvard Berkman Klein Center, wrote last year, it is this kind of evidence of causation and effect rather than purely of activity that we now need urgently. So how do we get there, and how do we get there quickly? I come out of a computational social science research center, which means policy is not one of our areas of expertise. But given that we're here in DC, I will use this opportunity to stress that the production of rigorous scientific research on these policy-relevant issues, and then getting that research into the hands of policymakers, requires expanded access to high-quality data. But the present difficulties in obtaining access to the relevant data cannot be overstated. Whereas most political research, until relatively recently, has utilized administrative data produced by the public sector or by researchers themselves, much of the data necessary to investigate the relationship between the internet and politics are now locked inside private technology companies. This means that the greatest data set ever amassed on human behavior is largely inaccessible to researchers who are committed to publishing insights in the public domain and for the betterment of society. Whether they are social scientists studying misinformation in elections, or the CDC using social media data to more quickly and accurately forecast suicide rates, which was reported on earlier this week. Responding to the latest scandal, both parties are rushing to fill the policy void with proposals on issues like digital advertising and harmful content regulation. If we want these policies to be informed by rigorous cutting-edge science, rather than by anecdote, folk wisdom, or breathless media coverage, we need to ensure that research can be undertaken with the necessary data. Data sharing paradigms can take many forms, and I urge you to read the work of Nate Persily at Stanford Cyber Policy Center and Joshua Tucker, one of our center faculty directors, who have explored how to overcome the various political, legal, and logistical barriers to data access for the research community. But regardless of what form a data sharing paradigm might ultimately take, it is imperative that data access for researchers be a crucial part of any legislative or regulatory response aimed at strengthening our democracy in the digital age.
Thank you so much, Steve. I'm going to move quickly. We'll move quickly to Ramsi.
Thanks, Mike. It's great to be here. I'm primarily an antitrust scholar, but a few years ago I got interested in advertising. And the reason I got interested in advertising was that I came across some law and economics literature about advertising that described the two main functions that economists recognize advertising to have. One of those functions is to manipulate, to change preferences, and the other, according to economists, is to inform. And I was sort of astonished by this, because when I read economics literature, I almost always find sort of robust defenses of sort of business, the business world, and economic and free markets and the status quo. And so I had expected to see a defense for advertising that was similarly robust, something I would have trouble arguing against. Something that would constantly slip through my fingers the way when I try to argue as an antitrust lawyer against high prices, I always find economists explaining to me all the reasons why high prices are actually good, they fund research and development, and so on and so forth. This defense of advertising that I found in the economics literature, that it is informative. And the economists recognize that it can be manipulative and that can be bad. And they say, well, it's informative. It's also informative, and that's its saving grace. Just struck me as so astonishingly thin relative to these other defenses of the business status quo that one finds in economics literature. So how can this be? Is advertising really informative? Is that what it's doing? Is it, when I see advertisements, is it providing me with useful product information? And I can kind of see how that might have been true before the internet. I can kind of see how that could have been true back in the days when you had to flip open the yellow pages in order to find a local store that did X or did Y. But it struck me that today, when we have access to the internet and to all the information on the internet and all the product reviews, from verified purchasers and all the websites, all the consumer websites, and everything, our friends and family on Facebook and so on, we have access to all this information about products. Do we really feel that we get useful product information from advertising? Clearly, in the information age, advertising's information function is obsolete. That is the starting point for some work I went on to do about advertising and antitrust, because it turns out that in the 50s, 60s, and 70s, the Federal Trade Commission viewed advertising's manipulative character as being anti-competitive. And the argument here I thought was pretty strong. the FTC said the foundation of the free market system, the foundation of competition, is consumer sovereignty. The idea that consumers dictate their preferences, their production preferences to firms, by signaling those preferences through their purchase decisions. And the foundation of that is the notion that consumer preferences are stable. If they're not, if they can be changed by the firms that are supposed to be taking the dictation, then the consumer isn't sovereign anymore. The consumer is not dictating their preferences to firms. Firms are dictating to consumers what it is they should buy. And so if advertising in its manipulative function is very much a threat to the core of the free market system, it's a threat to the entire justification, the entire efficiency proposition that the free market has for us. So economics has been aware of that, and the Federal Trade Commission was aware of this problem, but back in the 50s, 60s, and 70s, it could only bring cases in which the advertising clearly had no informative side to it. So, for example, probably the most famous case the FTC brought in this period was a case challenging the acquisition of Clorox bleach by Procter & Gamble. And the FTC said, well, all bleaches are chemically identical. So there's nothing that advertising for a particular form of bleach can tell you about the product that you're getting that would provide you with useful product information that would help you differentiate between a better product and a worse product. So the only function of advertising bleach is to manipulate. And the FTC said, well, Procter & Gamble has these advertising efficiencies because it advertises a huge range of goods on television, so it gets these bulk advertising discounts, and so once it buys Clorox, it's going to be able to advertise more cheaply than any other competitor in the bleach market, and so these other competitors in the bleach market, they'll lose in the advertising battle, and there's not going to be any gain to consumers from that because clearly the only thing that's going on here is manipulation because there's no information function to this advertising whatsoever. The FTC challenged and it won. In fact, won an opinion offered by Justice Douglas in the Supreme Court. So that was sort of the beginning of the FTC's campaign against manipulative advertising, but it ran into this wall, which was the argument that advertising is also informative. Once it ran out of cases in which you could clearly show that the only function of the advertising was manipulative, it just couldn't win any more cases. And antitrust went into decline starting in the 1980s. This particular program was abandoned. But now that we have the internet, now that it's clear that the information function of advertising is obsolete, and that all advertising is only, the only useful thing about advertising today is got to be useful for firms, has got to be its ability to manipulate, we can revisit this idea that advertising, all advertising, is fundamentally anti-competitive. And if we do that, that has huge consequences for the debate over the tech giants for obvious reasons. Google and Facebook make the vast amount of their money through advertising. And if we have an antitrust ground for saying that that entire project is anti-competitive and subversive of the free market system, then that solves a lot of problems involving issues of privacy and surveillance and so on. And also creates some because social media is useful. It's nice to have it, and if it can't be funded with ads, it needs to be funded somehow. Same thing with online search. It also has important implications for the great jeopardy that journalism finds itself in today as a result of the tech giants. So despite being an antitrust lawyer, I have to concede that that monopoly is sometimes good, and monopoly was certainly very good for journalism all through the 20th century. And journalism the heyday of American journalism was funded by local advertising monopolies. I mean, one major paper in every American city. Cha-ching. Lots and lots and lots of ad revenue, and it's the competition that Facebook and Google brought to those monopolies that is so threatening. That is so threatening journalism today. So is this solution, as some have argued, to break up the advertising monopolies that now are Google and Facebook, and to somehow allow American newspapers to compete more effectively in providing advertising services? My sense is no, that's not the right way to go. There's always something that is fundamentally contradictory and wrong about the fact that journalism as a truth-telling enterprise was financed by advertising as a manipulative enterprise. And this is a moment today when we have that source of funding drying up for news is, in my view, a golden opportunity for us to rethink how we fund the news, how we can find better ways to fund the news than through advertising. So I've spoken longer than I should have, so I will pass the time.
Thank you so much, Ramsi. Kathleen Parley.
Good afternoon, thank you for coming. I'm Kathleen Parley from Carnegie Mellon University, and I'm going to talk about this issue from a slightly more technological perspective. The area of disinformation and misinformation, propaganda, etc., within the social sciences and computer sciences is rapidly becoming referred to as social cybersecurity, a new scientific field aimed at keeping the internet free and open for democracy and political and social debate and discourse without undue influence and without disinformation. This is unlike cybersecurity, which is aimed at hacking the computer. This is social cybersecurity, is aimed at hacking the human. Now, disinformation propaganda, of course, have always been with us. They're not an invented just this generation. Think back to the Trojan horse. But with social media, it has taken on a new and dangerous twist. Information can, of course, spread faster, further, and with the consumer having less ability to actually understand who is spreading that information, and less ability to actually discern the difference between true and false information because of the affordances of the social media and the technology itself. To understand how disinformation is spread, it is important to understand how the internet and how people's discussions on the internet are structured. Basically, discussions on the internet are formed into something we call topic groups. That is a group of individuals who are conversing on a particular topic, such as everybody who saw all the plane spotters from a topic group, all those concerned with football, all those with world-class soccer, all those with capitals. You know, they're all each their own topic group. Topic groups come and grow, they vary in size, etc. But they can take on a pathological form, and that pathological form is, of course, the echo chamber. If they enter into, become an echo chamber, and they will do so for very short time periods, they basically start ignoring information from the outside, the individuals within it pass information extremely rapidly to each other, and they start responding to things emotionally. The individuals within it go through something that's called amygdala hijack and start not making decisions on the basis of rationality, but on the basis of emotions. So influence campaigns and the spread of disinformation is done in such a way to actually try to either create new topic groups or build these topic groups into an echo chamber or to merge topic groups together to make them go away. You might think that disinformation is all about spreading stories about the narrative, but in point of fact, the most effective campaigns out there have changed not just what is being said, but they've actually changed who is saying it and who you're talking to as you get your information around that topic. The tools that are used are things like bots, which are completely computer automated, cyborgs, persons with bots attached, trolls, which are humans under fake personas, memes, fake YouTube videos, deepfakes, etc. are some of the tools. But another tool that is commonly used and is often overlooked are these subtle emotional subconscious cues that are built into the actual images and the text that are sent that cause people to respond to things emotionally. We now have technologies for identifying and discovering many of these. But what we find is that in general, those groups that are spreading disinformation are effective because they're taking advantage of two things. One is they are taking advantage of the way in which the social media providers themselves operate. So each of the media providers has special built-in rules that they don't tell you about for how they prioritize information, do recommendations, etc. But these are more or less discoverable, and they're discovered by those spreading disinformation, and they build their messages to take advantage of those rules. Secondly, they take advantage of the way we as humans, our brains operate. One of the things that we do is when we become uncertain, we make our decisions on the basis of what we think everyone knows. That is using our social cognition. One of the things that effective campaigns do is they make it appear that everyone in your group is saying the same thing, even when they are not. We've seen these campaigns being effective in a number of different ways. For example, in the case of ISIS, they actually built these botnets to actually go out and take this one group, started retweeting information from the imam that would prioritize the message to everyone else in the group. And then after everyone else in the group started following this bot, the bot then started tweeting about this one site, saying, go to the site, you'd like to give money to it. And the site was known for collecting money for the children of Syria, thought to be a money laundering site for ISIS. So they actually redirected people to this. In the Euromaidan Ukrainian Revolution, another thing that was done, another example of disinformation campaigns, was they actually started by taking a group of young men who absolutely had no knowledge of each other, but they did like to share provocative pictures with women. So what they actually did, this influence campaign did, was it started sending out new messages about multiple ones of these young guys, eventually got all the guys to get recommended to each other simply by the tools themselves. Once they started paying attention to each other, they formed a group. At that point, they started sending their messages that kind of said, well, if you like these images of women, you should also want to go get these guns and go get involved in the fight, and here's where to go to do it. And they actually built an army from the ground up, basically. With elections more specifically, one of the common strategies that is used in most elections, we've seen this in every single election that has occurred in Europe in the past few years, as well as many of the events in South America. What you do is you find two groups that are pro and con on some issue. One favorite ones are anti and pro LGBTQ, anti and pro Semitic, anti and pro Muslim, anti and pro Catholic, anti and pro the US, anti and pro feminism. And what you'll do is you'll infiltrate both sides with bots and trolls and cyborgs. Infiltrate both sides. And then you start backing extremist leaders on both sides, so that their messages be sure to be heard. You start building connections among the people within those groups so they become more and more echo chambery. And then you start sending out or supporting messages of dismay in one group and messages of excitement in the other group, causing the groups to get very volatile and very upset and so on. We've actually seen this lead to the outbreaks of fights in some cases. In the Asia Pacific area, in their elections there, we've actually seen the second strategy, which is what we call the pump-up strategy, where you infiltrate both sides, but on one side what you do is you back the leaders of interest, you add connections among the group, you spread messages of excitement and happiness. But on the other side, what you do is you set up your messages and your messaging to actually break the group apart and cause people to stop paying attention to each other as much, as well as to send out messages of despair, so that they're like, oh, well, we can't do anything, and we don't even have anything to talk to anymore. And that has been very effective, and was used very effectively, for example, in promoting all of the politicians who were actually pro-Chinese interests in the elections in the Philippines and in Indonesia, for example. So what can you do about this? Are there any solutions? Well, we don't know yet, but we're starting to see a few of them. One of the things is the citizen participation. We have actually seen disinformation campaigns that are minor ones actually be completely countered by simply having individuals go on and call it out and say, this isn't true, this isn't true. Another thing that is helpful in stopping disinformation campaigns is the use of satire. You can actually, for example, after the Black Panther movie, they actually stopped the disinformation campaign that I got beaten up when I went to this movie by actually sending pictures out of like SpongeBob with with a band-aid on it. And that was their satire campaign. Those two things can be effective. There's many other strategies I'd like to talk about. But in point of fact, disinformation campaigns, when they're tied to groups that have an offline analog, they're going to last longer, they're going to be harder to stop, and they're going to be more entrenched, become more entrenched in the culture. They will also last longer and be harder to stop if you actually have them secondarily promoted by news agencies or fake news agencies, or secondarily supported by popular celebrities. Thank you.
Thank you, Kathleen. Lots of really good material here. I'm going to ask just a few questions. I'm going to ask one question for each of you, and then, but you're all welcome to answer. So let me just start with Zeev. Zeev, I think one question I want to ask is, here we are. We're fairly knowledgeable about, that is to say, we on the panel and many people here in this room are fairly knowledgeable about disinformation campaigns, so we're immune, right? I mean, since we're aware that these campaigns are happening, or we could become aware just by reading an article or two today, doesn't that just inoculate us from further influence or further undue influence?
So I want to pick up on something that you said in your introductory remarks that relates to this, which is that fake news or misinformation can actually sometimes include real information within that. But it's presented in a way that's intentionally deceiving or manipulative. And so we just finished a study at the Center for Social Media and Politics that was covered last week by the Financial Times, in which we tried to really unpack some of the mechanisms of individual level determinants of who is and isn't susceptible to fake news. And so if you all just sort of briefly sort of explain what the research was and then cover the main findings. And so every day we sourced 5 articles that were published within the previous 24 hours. 2 from mainstream sources, one that sort of seemed like it had an ideologically left bent and one from the right. And then 3 sort of fake news sources which came from various scholars' work. And every day we sent out these 3 articles to 150 people, so each of the 5 articles was assessed by 90 people. And then we also sent them out to 6 professional fact checkers. And one of the sort of really interesting top-level findings that came from this is that people, even really educated people, are tremendously bad at identifying fake news. And it's because when we think about what fake news is, we often think about things like Pizzagate. But that's not what the majority of the fake news ecosystem looks like. It is oftentimes real information that is sort of framed in very, very misleading ways in order to support theses or claims that are then not true. And not only was there a tremendous amount of disagreement amongst respondents, there also was amongst fact checkers. And so sort of the 3 big findings are that people were not very good. Under 40% of the time did people agree with the professional fact checkers on articles that came from these sort of misleading false article streams. They were pretty good at determining that the stuff that came from mainstream news were true. But what was fascinating was that a lot of the sort of demographic factors that we would think would relate to it, particularly age and education, weren't related to performance. Instead, it was things like political knowledge and how often people read the papers. And then finally, the last finding that I want to emphasize is that people were better at identifying misleading information when it came from a source that had cross-cutting partisanship. So if you were liberal, you were much better at identifying conservative misinformation, but also vice versa. And so the graphs almost look like exact mirrors of each other. And so I think uncovering the diversity of sort of the misinformation out there in the ecosystem and how susceptible people are 2 different types of misinformation is really important.
Okay, let's bookmark that fact because we're going to come back to it. Ramsi, I have a question for you, which is one of my favorite ads of all time was the 1984 Apple Macintosh ad at the Super Bowl. You know, if you haven't seen it, it's this ad in which a woman, there's this 1984 scene. You can certainly see it on YouTube now for free, so maybe that says something about free information on the internet. But there are a lot of nameless, unhappy people listening to Big Brother, and suddenly a woman comes and throws, hurls a hammer at the screen. She It's so exciting, it tells us literally nothing at all about what the Macintosh is about or why it was different. This is 1984, won't have to be like 1984. And to me, that's kind of really exciting, because if you were interested or knew about computers back in the late 70s or early 1980s, there was really nothing like the Macintosh for most people. Everybody was used to, you know, typing in commands or dealing with, control characters and so on. And so the Macintosh, which had a different way of approaching, one, by the way, that is now on all Windows machines and all Linux machines and all Macintosh machines, it would be hard to communicate that informationally. They say, oh yeah, you're going to be so much happier when you're moving icons around with a mouse. So, but what they did, the way the advertising worked was to manipulate people into going to the computer store and playing with it and seeing if they thought something was useful about that. Is that bad? I mean, ultimately, the paradigm shift for personal computing changed in what most people think was a positive way.
So my forays into the economics literature on advertising, I have learned that is what is called experiential advertising, and the justification for that, interestingly enough, is, well, in addition to, if you hadn't heard of Apple before, you now knew of the name of the product. The main justification for experiential advertising is goes to think of Calvin Klein ads on buses and Coca-Cola. You know it exists already, but you see it again, has been that it provides you with a piece of information that the firm advertises. And that is supposed to be a signal to you that the firm believes enough in its product and invests money in advertising it. And so I certainly credit that there is an information function to doing that, to sending a signal that you're so confident about your product that you're willing to invest in expensive advertising for it. In the information age, the age of the internet, when we can at our leisure find out about any product and read reviews about it and learn about it and learn that it exists, when we are interested in doing something or not, so we don't have that thrust upon us, firms can certainly avail themselves of that function simply by donating the equivalent amount to charity and then putting on their own websites that they have invested $1 billion, they've thrown away $1 billion on their product. And if that's useful information for you, you can Google search up that piece of information and find it on the firm's website. So in my view, advertising should still be allowed in limited sense that firms should be able to put information on their own websites about their products, but that should be it. And we can avail ourselves of that information if we want by searching for it. And when we're not interested in consuming advertising, we can choose not to search for it. And so in the world of today, if Apple were introducing an app for the first time, I recognize that this involves a great deal of anachronism and things don't fit right because it's already a computer age. But if Apple were doing it today, I suspect that we would have all learned about this amazing new computer very quickly through online word of mouth, through Google searches that we might have done to figure out what computer is there out there and to learn more about it. There's no need for the 1984 football commercial Apple advertisement anymore to ensure that product gets out. And in fact, I'd even hazard that absent that advertisement, if Apple's computer really was better than the competition at the time, it would have done just fine without it.
So what if the charity you want to contribute to is a newspaper or a search engine? I mean, it may well be that in order, it should be the case that the company say, well, I'm going to contribute, here's my charitable contribution to Google, to make sure that the searches work, or my charitable contribution to ProPublica to make sure that journalism happens. I mean, I'm wondering, a lot of capital gets moved around one way or the other to make sure that people know about the products. who's to say whether the charitable avenue is more efficient than just advertising, you know, the way we do it now?
If you accept, as I take it in your question, you do, that the advertisement doesn't have any useful information function other than the fact of giving, and you can get that, and you accept that you can, those who are interested in find that to be a relevant fact can Google it up at their leisure to find it, then any investment, any spending of that charity money on the advertising itself is wasteful, because you're spending a lot of money producing something that you don't have to spend in order to get the exact same information output, which is to reach people and tell them that you've been willing to spend a lot of money backing your product. Right? So that money is better. We know for a fact, if you concede all that, that money is wasted in actually going through the process of producing the advertisement. And potentially the expenditure on some other charity would be more productive. There's the possibility of productiveness spending it somewhere else, whereas you have the certainty of unproductiveness if you spend it in producing the advertisement itself. So I don't see prohibiting such advertisements as being economically problematic.
Thanks. Kathleen, I want to talk a little bit more about amplification of disinformation. I mean, one of the things that, and Zeev also mentioned, Yochai Benkler, who has done a lot of work on this topic. Sometimes the mainstream media, that is to say the newspapers and journals, are themselves channels for amplification of disinformation. And it's partly because the fact of disinformation can itself become news. I mean, it's kind of weirdly perverse, right? The fact that there's a disinformation campaign or an influence campaign becomes news, and suddenly it's amplified just for that reason. That's part one of my question. Part two of it is what happens when people act like bots? Because sometimes there's a genuine, a meme that is genuinely popular and it spreads around and people, and it's not really necessarily a function of a particular disinformation campaign, but the meme itself is kind of viral all by itself. And it doesn't always involve a kitten either. So when that thing propagates, when people are acting like bots, sometimes they're spreading misinformation or disinformation around that way. And what might our social response be to that? So mainstream amplification and people acting like bots.
So first thing I would say is that in terms of amplification, most disinformation campaigns will start like in blogs or in news sites or in mainstream news sites that now have been published disinformation intentionally. We'll start there, it will then go out to Facebook and Twitter, be re-amplified by YouTube, back into Twitter for secondary amplification, and so on. What we find in general is that if a mainstream news site that is not known for spreading disinformation starts talking or writing stories about that disinformation, the disinformation will last longer in the press because more people want to know what it's about because they read about it, okay? But you will also get more information about why it is not true at the same time. So kind of have both effects. So that's the amplification part. In terms of people acting like bots, that's actually really funny because we run various bot detection techniques all the time. And we often find that many celebrities look like bots. Over 70% of all incumbent politicians look like bots, and so on. And partly they look like bots because they have staffers and staffs who send out messages very rapidly because of their movement and other things. So they will have the characteristics of that. But just because someone looks like a bot does not mean that they are spreading information in the same way a bot would spread misinformation and disinformation. So a lot of the bots, the considering when bots are used to spread disinformation, it's often done in a very strategic manner, meaning that they will target certain groups with that information and they will aim the information there. They will build connections among the people in those groups first and then send the disinformation. They will time their messages in certain ways. And you don't see that in humans who have bot-like characteristics. So they look very different.
Thank you, Kathleen. Because I made Steve go first, I'm going to give him one chance to question or comment on what our other panelists have said. This is the prize of going first, or this is the award for going first. And then we're going to have an opportunity for questions from the audience. And what I'll do, since I don't think you all have access to mic, is I will repeat the question if those of you who have questions want to ask them. Steve?
Yes, I just want to very quickly pick up on something that Ramsi did. Discussing, which was the sort of manipulation function of online advertising. I think that one of the other really important things to understand is not just the manipulative function of online advertising, but really being skeptical about whether there's a manipulative effect of online advertising. And by when I say skeptical, I just mean we need to study it a lot more. I think that this narrative emerged from 2016 that if you sort of pair psychographic information with cutting-edge data science, there are going to be sort of digital sorcerers out there who are changing everyone's opinions and beliefs in ways that they want. And I think that given sort of the broad literature from both psychology and political science on sort of attitude opinion formation, we should be skeptical of that, but we need a lot more research on the effects of advertising in the digital age. Digital advertising is extremely difficult to work with, in part because technology companies don't want to give us much access to ads, but also because they're incredibly cheap to make and iterate on. And so whereas for the television format, it'll be very expensive to make a 30-second ad, online you can make 20 iterations of the same ad incredibly quickly. One with picture A, one with picture B. One says donate now, one says contribute. And all of those have different engagement rates. And so when we study it, it becomes really challenging in an environment like this, it would be incredibly helpful if there was a sort of regulation around ensuring that researchers could study it, because the data was much easier to both access and work with.
Thanks. We're going to have some questions, I hope, but I was just to address the elephant and the donkey in the room. Political ads often address, make emotional appeals. The question is, how do we think about political ads, which may themselves be interpreted as not merely manipulative, but fundamentally, or maybe exclusively manipulative? How should we think about dealing with political ads in a culture if that's our take on how advertising works? And I'm going to ask this of all the panelists if you have comments on this, and then we'll just try to have a few minutes left for questions at the end. So I know Ramsi will have some thoughts. So.
So manipulation is part of politics, and I've got no problem with that. That's part of politics. We want to be manipulated into realizing or understanding something or taking a position we didn't take before. Politics is not just a rational process, but the market is different. The foundation of economic theory what allows us to say that the free market is efficient is the assumption that consumers are in command of their own preferences. That's what allows us to say that the market is efficient, that it serves consumers best. It does what they want. Why? Because consumers don't buy the stuff they don't like. And firms that produce it go out of business. With manipulative advertising, firms that produce stuff that is not the stuff that consumers think is best can still survive and profit and even succeed because they can manipulate consumers' preferences. So there's something that doesn't add up in markets where you allow manipulation. And I think the Supreme Court in its First Amendment jurisprudence has actually, you know, almost inadvertently done a great job of recognizing this, because the Supreme Court generally protects commercial speech, but not when the speech interferes with the ability of consumers to make independent buying decisions. And that's why, for example, the Federal Trade Commission has the power to ban, to put a stop to false advertising, because false advertising, you know, certainly makes it hard for consumers to exercise their preferences independently. And manipulative advertising does the same thing. Right? And so commercial speech is special.
More comments, Kathleen?
So, I was going to say that with respect to political ads and relying on emotions, the main point I would make there is that any kind of emotional appeal when it comes out in an ad or whatever, if you can tell who it's from, if you know the context in which it is in, is less disruptive to having a political discourse than if you don't. So it's not that they're emotional that's a bad thing. It's not that they're on politics that's a bad thing. It's not that they're an ad that's a bad thing. But it's when you get an ad that you don't know is really an ad, that is carrying the disinformation, it is carrying it in an emotional way, and you have no idea who it's from, or worse yet, it's masking itself as though it's from your best friend, then you have a problem.
Do you have any thoughts, Pat?
I just want to echo exactly what Kathleen said. It's sort of the principles of sort of regulating online advertising on television or sunshine and accountability. You just need to tell people who has financed it, who's the speaker, and then you allow sort of voters the ability to hold politicians accountable. Once you know the information, the sort of scary and new thing about the online world is that you don't always know who's the speaker there.
So we have some time for one or two questions. Does anybody have any questions, things like that? And one of the things I want to underscore is that our experts here, and also a network of people that we have that we're sharing research with, are potential resources for you and for your bosses if you have questions that you want to ask about possible laws or regulation dealing with disinformation or misinformation online. So we will make a point of making everybody's contact information available to anyone who asks. And I just want to footnote that and see if there are any questions.
Yes.
So the question, as I understand it, and I didn't identify here all of it, but I'm pretty sure I know it's about, which is micro-targeting. And as many of you know, it's possible to use the data that you collect through social media platforms and other online platforms to micro-target or pick particular demographic groups or people of different sorts in a fairly narrow and not always transparent way. And how does micro-targeting affect our judgments about, you know, public policy or what needs to be done? How do we assess that?
So we actually found lots and lots of instances of micro-targeting, partly because, and usually it was under micro-targeting around a group where there was an obvious pro and anti on some issue, and so they would do that. The worst thing that we saw about micro-targeting is that for the, for lack of a better word, the minority group, okay, the actual target group, is that by being targeted in that way and realizing it, and once they recognized they were being manipulated, they often took their voices out of the debate. And so you would see groups just saying, we're getting attacked online, we're getting people coming in pretending they're in part of us and they're not, we're getting bots in our group, we're getting trolls attacking us, we're just gonna go radio silent. And they would go into other forums where they could talk alone just to themselves. And that's a tragedy because they're no longer part of the political debate.
One of the hallmarks of the information age has been the way manipulative, the capacity of advertising to manipulate has moved from being generated by advertising agencies, by the content, the advertising content creators, to becoming hardwired into the distribution infrastructure itself. So if you think back to, you know, the heyday of newspapers serving as advertising, local advertising distributors, the newspaper provided the space, but the content was provided by an ad agency that was tasked with figuring out, you know, how to actually get the message across. But now with micro-targeting, and you have a situation in which the distributor contributes to the manipulative effect by allowing the kind of tailoring that that plays on mental weaknesses. And that, I think, has important consequences for how we think about whether there's a future for newspapers as providers of advertising distribution, because now they become, in order for them to be competitive, they have to be partaking in this data collection and micro-targeting and manipulation in a way that they could sort of keep themselves one step removed from in the past.
So we're right at the end of our time, but before I'm going to give Seth a chance to have a last word, I just want to add one thing about micro-targeting, which is that I have the experience, and I know many of you have the experience, which is that all the search engines and the social media platforms send me stuff that adds to my Macintosh. They send me a bunch of Apple-related advertising, so because they know, apparently, that I click on those ads and that I apparently buy a lot of stuff that's related to those products. And so, interestingly, it's not exactly manipulative in the way that traditional advertising is, because instead of shifting my mind away from things that, you know, thoughts that I otherwise, you know, that I otherwise would have had, it's actually reinforcing preferences that I may already have expressed. And I just want to underscore that little piece of it. So I'm going to give you a chance for one final comment, and then we'll adjourn.
So very quickly, I think this is a fantastic question. I think that we talk about micro-targeting frequently and for good reason. I think one of the interesting things, though, when we talk about micro-targeting is how few specifics we have to talk about micro-targeting because of how invisible it is rendered by these technology companies. And so this I want to quickly come back to this question of sort of how do we know what we know? Right now, when it comes to political advertising, we have no idea how campaigns are micro-targeting certain demographics, and that's information that I think should be public knowledge, that researchers can not only get a better sense of what campaigns are doing, but also what effect it has on voters.
Thank you all very much. I think some of us